good. Solid. Right on.
Mother, mother, there's too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying. No, we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Hey, Father, Father, we don't need to escalate. You see, war is not the answer, for only love can conquer hate. Don't punish me, sister, with brutality. Sister, talk to me, sister, so you can see. Sister, oh, what's going on?
What's going on?
What's going on?
What's going on?
Yeah, what's going on?
What's going on?
Oh, what's going on?
What's going on?
Good morning, afternoon, evening, whatever time you're tuning in the program called What's Going on FlintTalkRadio.com. I'm George Moss, the host of the program, and I'm very glad to see this afternoon our co-host is Ms. Catherine Hunter Williams.
Hello.
Catherine, welcome again to the program. And we're very glad to have those of you out there in the listening audience with us as well, and hope you will do what some of the callers are doing, and that's call in with your comments and tune us in and let us know what you're thinking about. As we say always on this program, that whatever we're talking about and we get a caller, and the caller says that I want to talk about something else, then we will, in fact, shut up
and let him talk,
and let
or
you
her.
Talk and go to what your interests would be and cover those issues as well. We do have a format we follow here, but it's not written in stone, and we're very glad to accommodate the viewers and the listening audience with what they feel is probably more pertinent than the topics we bring to the table. So if you
see,
feel,
now I didn't know we had a format.
Well, we have a format. We do current events issues.
Okay. And, I didn't know we had one. Yeah. Did you, John? Did you know he had one? Okay.
You think that these articles I've been bringing in, that I just simply made this up?
No.
I'll tell you what the format will be for the first couple of minutes of the program will be this person that captured from the...
The
out of Georgia. Yeah, the Slasher.
Stabber Slasher.
Yeah, the Slasher, and I was very glad to read that we are no longer having to be terrified about his presence out there on the street. Mm. You know, I went to pick up one of the professors who was going home to Nigeria, and I had to pick him up at 3:30 to take him to the airport to arrive at the airport at 4 o'clock. His plane was leaving out at 6. It was dark out there, and I'll tell you something, this is before they caught the Slasher. I was really looking over my shoulder. I went outside of my house, and before I got off the porch, I looked both ways. Then I proceeded to the car. I went hurriedly to the car, got in, locked the doors. I was taking every precaution I could because, you know, you just don't know what's going on.
Yeah, now they are aware, people are aware, because at first we was hearing about the stabbings, but we thought because of all the violence that was going on, it was just a more black-on-black crime. But after it's, you know, the information got out that it was a slasher, a serial stabber going on out there, then the people became aware. Then they start, you know, arming themselves. I seen a brother in the paper with he had a
this picture
knife
right here.
Yeah, you know, so he's armed, and you know, they ain't gonna let him just approach him like that anymore. That'll never happen ever again.
Well, you know, the thing that was interesting is that the slasher was out there, probably starting on his murderous course in May, but they really hadn't gotten a pattern of what was going on. Mm-hmm. So he had been out there for a while before we began to see, hey, there's a stalker out there.
Yeah,
that's luring people into his net.
But once they got on it, they caught him quickly.
I was really amazed at the police work, and there's some parts of this story that has not been released, in terms of how they use technology to track this guy down.
Cell phone, probably.
Yeah, and they were saying that they were using that technology, some of which they don't want to release to the public because obviously they don't want to have the word get out of how they actually would go about tracking people.
The motivation, too, I would like to know what that is.
That's going to be interesting,
too. What motivated him, because when he first started off, he was doing it, but he wasn't doing it every day. It would maybe once a week or something like that. You know, if you watch this timeline. Mm-hmm. And then he starts stepping up daily.
Yeah, there's...
And then had nerve to leave Michigan and go somewhere else and do it. I mean, goodness gracious.
Yeah, that's going to be interesting. You know, you and I talked off camera and over the weekend about some of the rumors. We're not going to go over until we find some factual basis for it. But there are some stories that are swirling around about what this motivation was. And it'll be interesting to see what we have information-wise right now.
Yeah, because I want to know the motivation.
I do, too.
Yeah, I want to know
that. I think that the community is owed an explanation about what this is all about.
Well, why he did that and why he was targeting black men. But he did throw off a little bit when he did a couple of whites. You know, at least one that I know of in Flint, you know, they he messed the brother up. He messed them all up. And to me, he was trying to gut them. Because he would start from in the center of their stomach and he would move all the way up. Like, that's gutting.
I have a hard time understanding the mindset you have to be in to do those kinds
of horrifying crimes. To do that. And to walk up on them and just, you know, with a pretense that you need help or some directions. And once you get up on them, what's in their mind? They, you know, I'm finna kill this guy. That's what's in their mind.
I just wonder how you sleep at night, having done something like that. And here you are luring people into your net who are trying to come to the rescue. They think that you're in distress. And they try to help you. And then you turn on them and slash them like that. I don't know what kind of mindset.
That's a nightmare. That would be a nightmare for the person that was stabbed.
Yeah, that's amazing.
But also when they caught him and he was saying, he waved his right down there to be extradited back to Michigan, and he said something like, that's the only right thing to do is to go back to Michigan. I didn't understand that.
He was just saying that it makes no sense to postpone the inevitable. They're going to extradite him back to Michigan one way or the other. Mm-hmm. If he fights it, then that's going to be a 90-day delay, but it's still going to happen.
It's going to happen. Did he have help, George, you think? Well, I've heard that he had help. One of the boys said that it was another man in the car.
Well, the question is whether or not there's another person out there. I mean, another situation that's out there that we have not yet gotten a hold of, because one of the person that was victimized, maybe not by this person, said that his attacker ran across the street and got into a car, which was driven away by another person.
Somebody else.
So this person seemed like he was doing his work individually. So is there another person out there?
Copycatter?
Yet to be caught. I know one thing, I'm not going to let my guard down and assume that...
I didn't let mine down either, and I knew that they
were
saying...
All is well and good at this point.
They were saying that they are targeting men, but you just never know when he might switch and say, I'm finna get some women.
Right, right.
So I was on guard all the time.
Yeah, I think that we have to just continue to be vigilant in terms of how we go about doing our business, particularly late in the evening and early in the morning. This seemed to be
when
these attackers were out.
Mm-hmm. In the darkness.
You know something, the only way I'm going to be walking the streets, and that's if my car stalls or I have to go get some help for my car, and I'm not going very far to do that.
Yeah. But, George, after they caught him and everything, I think the night they said that he was caught, two killings happen over there on Pasadena?
Well, you know, and one of my friends texted me.
There's too much violence going on. These is our children. We need to grab these. These is young folks, ain't they?
One of my friends texted me yesterday morning, and I guess he had read the newspaper, and said, we're back to business as usual.
Yes.
In Flint.
And, you know, you could get insensitive and not this kind of stuff. Well, it happens all the time over here. So that you don't be bothered by it, you know?
Did you see the Dateline program that they did on the violence in Chicago? They did a Dateline special.
Mm-mm.
On Channel 25. And they were covering the violence just in the city of Chicago and making this point that these children just are endangered. You know, just the fact that you go to school, I can imagine what the parents are going through. You send your child to school, and you're really nervous about their leaving, and you are really on pins and needles until they get back.
Until they get back. Because especially the one, that little boy that they killed and it was caught on camera.
With that plane? That boy that they hit him with?
Yeah, him. I mean, you know, this is what I'm saying. This is our children. And somewhere the ball got dropped, you know, because there's no guidance, no consciousness about life, no respect. It's our children, and only we can save our children. Ain't nobody else going to do this.
In that special they did on Dateline, it is interesting. That's taking place in Chicago. It is just interesting how they go into a city and they're discussing the problems that are taking place in the community, and noticeably missing are these persons that purport to be speaking on behalf of the black community or black leaders. Jesse Jackson lives in Chicago, for mm-hmm. example. Why is it, not even on camera? No comments made when that situation prevails.
At all?
Nothing. Somehow they are MIAs, missing in action. But
no money
when
involved,
some external things are taking place, they're the first ones to the microphone. But yeah, that was that special there. But how many of these urban communities with that special not fit in terms of the profile of what's taking place in these communities? This stuff is going on in urban communities all over the country.
Yeah.
And just Chicago.
And the Chicago supposed to be addressing it, but I don't see where they are. I mean, you know, I'm sure they meet and what, but what are they doing? You know what I mean? What are they really doing?
Well, the church is doing its job in the sense that, though, I bet you those are not church members out there doing these crimes. And so
I don't know.
I don't think you. I don't think the church goes.
I think it is some of them church going youth out there killing one another. Yes, I do.
You'd have to split. You have to have a split
personality. Just think about the little boy. The boy, he was 17, that killed his mother. Yes, I do.
Yeah, now that.
Okay.
Yeah,
that's church going.
Yeah, though I think those are kind of like exceptional cases. I'm not talking about you certainly would have exceptional instances where that will take place. But Catherine, this continuous assault on our community.
So are you saying that these youth that's out there are not church-going people?
I would have a hard time
believing
that.
I believe their family, their parents might have raised them in the church and then they went left field.
Well, yeah, yeah. But in your church.
Or the parents didn't go to church at all. my generation, my children went to church.
Mm-hmm.
Or Muslim or mosque or whatever. I pulled them in because I wanted them to know about the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
But they have a whole different view on going to church. I'm not going to church. Mm-hmm. Don't do me no good.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
You know?
Yeah, but if they're going, where's the mindset? If they take themselves to church, is their mindset when they're going to church, is their mindset then after they leave church to go out there and tear the community up?
It may be with the youth. The youth is something else.
Yeah, we need to see.
You think it's drugs? I think it may be a lack of jobs, number one. And as this boy has said, it was nothing else that he could do. He had a felony on him. A lot of them, you know, are being incarcerated and they get felonies. And it's hard for them to get a job. But you're a man. You got to get out here and you got to do something to take care of you if you got a family, you got to do that. Okay, if you can't get a job, then you'll start doing the drug scene. And that drug scene is where a lot of the murders are taking place.
Yeah, I'd like to see a study made on the profile of these persons involved in these crimes in these urban communities. It's too consistently going on.
George, it's really going on. It's, mm-hmm. I mean, yeah. Flint, sometimes it's the little streets that I zoom through because I don't want to have to stop or be bothered. I won't let I have been approached. You know how you ride with your window down over on the other side?
Mm-hmm.
And somebody come up to your window and stick their head in your car when you're at a stoplight or stop sign? I mean, I've had this happen.
Really?
Really. Now I ride with my window up a little higher so they can't just come up. They just put their hands on the windshield. Not windshield, but the window. And stick their head in, you know, and you ride, and you ain't even paying no attention. That scares you. So this is downtown. This is anywhere.
I don't ride with my window down anymore. I used to ride with my window down because I'm a cheapskate, and I don't want to turn my air on because it costs more money to run the car.
It do. It takes a lot
but
when you're running that air.
I run my air conditioner now, and I pull my windows, roll my windows all the way up.
But that's a bad perception of Flint.
And but it's real. Like, you just have to be aware of the environment. And and I try to, when I'm driving down certain streets, I try to time my stoppage.
Yeah.
So I'm not speeding to the light to stop. I'm timing it so that when I get to the light, it's changed.
Yeah.
And I keep on driving.
Keep on going. I went and talked to, I work down there, you know, down there, I'll be down there at Page's Bookstore. And I went and talked to Jeff next door, Economy Print.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, Jeff, we need to put a buzzer or something so if I need some help over here, I can push the buzzer. And you can hear me and come save me because there's nothing there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and if you get caught up, let me leave that alone. I'm not going to open that door and let somebody come in and, you know, I could tell them how they could do something down there. No. But it's the same for Jeff, too. You know, we both look out for one another down there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, we have to continue to be vigilant. We don't know if there are some other persons out there. Of course, you always have these copycat persons out there as well that follow in the footsteps of the of these kinds of high publicized events. So we want to just maintain our vigilance. Let me tell you another thing that I have been looking at as far as the story breaking in the news, and that is how the news covered the event of who this person was. For case in point, on the front page of yesterday's journal, in the article, Unbowed, Many Wary But Defiant in the Face of Fear on Flint Streets. In the article, it says that police arrested Elias, I guess his name is, Abuel Lozan, a party store clerk, while he prepared to board a flight to Tel Aviv, Israel. Now, they dropped that Israel in there. Which I understand you're identifying where Tel Aviv is located. You're going to put Israel in there. But then you see this on the following pages in an article on page A3. It says in the storyline, suspect won't fight returned. And listen to this, Catherine. It says, Israeli caught in serial stabbing manhunt expected back in state within 2 weeks. Now, when I read this, and I put that on what they have, put that with what they have on the front page, Israeli.
If they say it's Israeli, they're saying he's Jewish.
When you say
my
Israeli,
understanding, I thought he was Arab.
Well, that's the point I'm trying to make. That what is the impression?
Palestinian.
Because you see, there could be a lot more specificity in the identity of this person than what is being given here.
You know, at one point they wouldn't give out their ethnicity. They said, we will not divulge it. After they found out that it wasn't a white guy, they would not give out that ethnicity until later they gave it out.
Well, it seems to me that they're actually hiding it behind these kinds of geographical markers, going to Tel Aviv, Israel, and then on the next page, on page 3, you see where they're saying in the storyline, Israeli. Well, when you say Israeli, aren't you thinking about Jews?
My understanding too that I heard that he was Muslim, but they called him a Jewish Christian. So well, what's going on with that? And then another thing.
I think they're leaving it out there to. I just don't think that this is an honest kind of reporting, based on how I see the media playing a role in cultivating and a climate through which an understanding can be given from a kind of perspective that's being put out there by the way in which the news is, in fact,
they want to take it
given.
All, say that he is not Arab, that's what they're saying.
I think that when
Arab,
you start looking at these kinds of topic, Israeli, as if, you leave it out there, when there's a need to, given how we see what you mean
he
by Israeli.
He looks like he's an Arab, though.
Yeah, well,
or Arab.
I mean, there's no question about the fact this is not a Jewish person. But the way the article is, the headline is reading, it leaves the reader to draw that conclusion. It doesn't say Jewish person as such. But to say Israeli, it leaves out there, we're talking about a nationality that's not really what this person's nationality is.
Right.
And I'm saying, why would you do that? See, I'm very conscious of that.
Is it kind of like a cover-up?
I see it happening too much for me to think that this is accidental. I want to give you a case in point. You may have heard this case last week with Dr. Laura Schlesinger that was on the radio last week. She had a caller that called in, and the caller said she was interracially married and was seeking some advice about how to deal with some of her husband's friends.
Yeah, I heard that story.
who she felt were making racial
slanted
comments. And so, anyway, Laura Schlesinger gave some advice to this woman. Next thing I know, here on CNN, they have the discussion took place under the banner of Al Sharpton deals with let's see, what was the wording? Deals with the.
She used the word nigger a
yeah,
lot.
Yeah, the N word rant of Laura Schlesinger. In other words, they're going to say it was a rant, like the woman was raving mad that she was.
She apologized though.
Screaming. Well, of course, because the political correctness demands that. A black person wrote an article, by the way, and said, "Here's another case of person apologizing." For nothing, because what was the violation here? I listened to that whole tape because I wanted to go back and see what was in fact said in that
tape. Well, she said the word I can't be politically correct. She said black people use nigger among themselves as an enduring term,
and that's the context.
You know, and that's
word.
What it was about. Yeah,
rather than her using.
Why can't if y'all do it? It's like it's a double standard. We know
it's
a
double
standard with that word.
It is a double standard.
You know, so
and she didn't play into what is what Shelby Steele says is racial etiquette, racial politeness. And
sometimes I don't think you can be polite, George.
She the woman was not ranting. And for them to, for CNN to bring Sharpton on and act like he was dealing with, quote unquote, a rant by Schlesinger is just the media framing the issue. That's what I'm getting at, how the media frames the issue as if something took place that never took place. It's almost like they're making it up out of whole cloth that they're creating these issues and then acting like these issues show that we are still saturated with all this racism. When Laura Schlesinger,
they just keep doing it. The media plays.
The media is playing this.
This does that. You know, keep the racism alive.
Those comments were very measured, and Schlesinger was simply making the point that it all depends on the context. And she used the word, we say the N word, and she
that's
used,
politically
and,
correct.
That's politically correct. But she used the word, and the lady all of a sudden, if the caller no longer was listening to the advice she was being given, she was just offended. That Laura Schlesinger would use the actual word, and that's where that's where the conversation got out of control, where it no longer was the advice that was being imparted, it was the word itself that had become the point of the conversation, and her apology is simply just being politically correct. She should have stood on her laurels and said that I was making this point. Where we can continue to have the dialogue that's necessary about race. We can't have it because political correctness gets in the way. Mm-hmm. But that's how the media, I think, is framing this.
Like this here, you're talking about this. They using the word Israeli.
Israeli.
When actually he's a Arab.
Palestinian.
A Palestinian, and it's a lot of Palestinians that own stores here in the city of Flint.
And why would they do that? See,
It's a lot of stores that are owned by Palestinians in the city of Flint.
But is it the media's? Let's say that would be true, and I think that has some credibility to it in terms of why they're framing.
Especially in the black neighborhood, but actually on the white neighborhood too, George, just right around.
Okay, but the question is whether or not the media should play the role of sanitizing the news because of how it plays out in the public. Isn't their job to report the news?
Well, you know,
and to be as objective as they can in reporting the actual facts.
Supposed to, but if I went into the store now and I know he's a Arab or Palestinian, I'm really going to be looking at him.
I don't know why I would blame other persons for this person's act. I mean, it's not.
Would be looking at them
with a jaundiced eye. But why would you, in fact, say that? I mean, why? That's what the media would assume, apparently.
That's right. It would assume it.
Yeah, but I don't want to paint any situation with a very broad brush in terms of this occurred, and
most of my relatives, George.
Yeah, but this guy is out here doing this. The man that 100 blacks, according to the reports, went outside this store where he was working. You mm-hmm. heard about that, right, on Coward mm-hmm. Road. And they were out there saying, you knew. Well, how do they know that he knew? How do they, the reports we have is that the FBI was saying that he was cooperating with the police, that they commended him for his cooperation.
Uh-huh.
And so this one guy is out here doing something behind his employer's back. We don't have any proof.
Maybe.
We don't have any proof, but I don't have any proof that.
No, we don't.
Okay.
And might not ever get no proof.
And until I get the proof, I can't go out there in front of this guy's place saying you knew.
To read between the lines.
But how do you go out there and make the claim that the employer knew?
And the police knew.
But look at what the police said about this guy, that the owner or the manager of that place was cooperating with the police. What evidence do we have otherwise, other than the fact he was cooperating? And in fact,
all we have is exactly what you said. They call it Israeli. All right. So now we have what the media tell us, but read between the lines. Sometimes you have to look underneath things. You know, go a little further, go a little deeper.
Yeah.
Okay.
But I'm saying that I think that they're framing the news so that you draw these conclusions. They didn't actually say that he was Jewish, but I mean that's what you leave it out
there.
But
it says Israeli, and that's what you think. If you know anything about Israel, you would say, "Oh, he's Jewish."
Okay. Did the press then have a responsibility of being specific?
If he's so Palestinian, say it.
Then why? That, and then the question is, why
Which
didn't
really
they do
mess
that?
Up some people because they don't know what Palestinian.
Yeah.
You have to say,
yeah, Israel, Tel Aviv, Israel. I think that there's something going on here that is very troublesome in terms of another way of editorializing and therefore planning some information in such a way, framing it in such a way, as you draw the wrong conclusion.
Thank you.
And I think we have to be aware of that and not allow ourselves to be led in that kind of way by the media that seems to be, you know, editorializing.
Some people know the truth out there, George.
It need not do that.
Some people know the truth.
I mean, I see the news, when you say ranting, and I go and listen to the tape where there's no ranting going on.
I mean, with the word when the woman?
Yeah.
Now you're off on another subject.
My subject is the media framing things in a way where it leads to conclusions that are not true based upon the evidence.
Yeah. Well, they're doing it for a purpose too, aren't they?
It just raises a question: why would they be doing that if they don't have a purpose behind it? There's no ranting. There's no ranting going on here. In the Laura Schlesinger case, we have a more specific identification of this guy in this case, and yet none of that information is given in a way in which it shows impartiality.
Do you remember the Atlanta murders?
I do remember.
When they was killing all of the boys down
mm-hmm.
there in Atlanta.
Mm-hmm.
They arrested a black man, right?
Walter Williams.
Who to this day is saying that he didn't do it.
Yeah.
And, you know, some people know the truth of what really actually happened. If they had if it was a white person that was running around, white man going around, killing all these children like they say, rumor,
mm-hmm.
that city would have been torn apart.
Yeah.
Okay. So there's certain things that are reported that you're not just going to hear what they want you to know.
Mm-hmm.
The media has that power to let you know what they want you to know.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to find the truth out, you got to go out there and do some researching and digging yourself.
No question. And I think that's why.
And he got people that's talking. This the slasher.
Mm-hmm.
He's got people that are telling things too, okay? It's got to come out. It's going to come out one way or the other, whether it's through the media or from people, black people. You know how we have a grapevine going on?
Mm-hmm.
We'll start talking about certain things that's going on, and it'll get out. It ain't.
Yeah.
The drum,
mm-hmm.
you know, speaks sometime.
We have to be more analytical so that these kinds of things don't happen, where we're being led into a conclusion that the evidence does not support. We have to be looking
at
the
evidence. I want to see what his uncle says.
At the evidence, but it's happening too much.
And I wonder if his uncle was the other driver. You know, the person that they say they seen this man and another man in the car. Was that the uncle?
Well, I'm, the question is...
And the uncle is supposed to be very cooperative, too.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just, give us the truth. Tell us the truth.
Yeah. Well, I think they've given us what they have.
And once the truth come out, then you can deal how you want to, you know?
Well, I think they've given us what they have. The question is whether or not there's another person out there, and not all of these stabbings can be attributed to this one individual.
Well, that one...
He seems to have been working alone.
You said it was the boy. Wasn't that the boy who gave the description?
I think this one happened on Sunset and Ballinger. I think that's one of the persons that survived it. And he said that the person that attacked him ran across the street and got into a truck, and the other guy drove
it off. So the truck was a SUV.
Right.
Okay.
Well, but maybe there are some. Maybe there's another person out there. I don't know. But I think that the police did a good job in terms of
catching
this guy and using the technology
they
used to bring about his capture.
But a lot of people died. A lot of young men died.
Yeah, I'm objecting to the way
that are not
the media frames
dead,
it.
They have
frames the news sometimes.
Will have issues, health issues for the rest of their lives.
Oh,
if not just physically, but mentally also.
Yeah, this is the point.
So he destroyed a lot of people.
This is the point that's missed in terms of how we put information into the equation of what's going on. I think that's a story. But another story is, how was it covered by the media? That's a story also. And I think that this framing it in ways in which it makes it. You posit that this was blacks and Jews. I think that framing of that Israeli caught in serial stabbing and so on, I think that is problematical and intentional in terms of how.
Well, you know, they always said blacks and Jews didn't get along. Okay.
They've had the closest relationship of any of the ethnic groups.
Who?
The Jews and the blacks, more so than the Jews and than blacks and Arabs. Where were the Arabs in the civil rights movement, for example?
We know they were not there. They
there
but for
the Jews
themselves.
Were there. The Jews were...
Some of the Jews.
We're advising. I'm just simply saying that the relationship between blacks and Jews has been historically a closer relationship than blacks in any other in part of the ethnic population. And that's why this to me, when I saw this, I said, well, now what's going on here? Because I know that store on the corner of Coldwater and Martin Luther King is really Detroit Street or out there. That store is not a Jewish owned, and I know that that person would not be working for an Arab unless he was Arab himself.
Thank
the way
you.
Is that reported in this article? Why are they leaving it out here?
Now you see in between the lines.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Thank
we, have to, we have to read between the lines.
Yeah.
But I don't want to infer things that we don't have information. And then draw a conclusion based upon that.
Well, we're seeing theories and rumors.
Yeah,
I just think actual facts.
We see cooperation by the gentleman that was a manager there, and that's what the reports are. That's the only information I have along that line of any culpability of the other persons that was inside that store. It seems like this person wasn't in there communicating that he was in fact doing these things, and one else inside of that particular place. I don't have any evidence other than that. But in terms of reading between the lines, Catherine, that's another thing that we got into this morning in terms of another issue that came up, talking about reading between the lines, the building of this mosque in New York. And, you know, everybody's talking about the right to religion, the right to practice religion.
That's what America is built on.
But here's a reading between the lines that no one has come to, and that is this, that does a country have the right to defend itself? And I make that point because what's being missed in this discussion, in my own estimation, is does a country have a right to defend itself against jihad? And jihad is not just flying planes into buildings. Jihad is also what Robert Spencer writes about in a book called Steph Jihad. It's not all about flying planes in the building. It's also.
But I thought this was a mosque. Nothing about jihad or any of that.
Jihad has many different forms.
All right.
And one form is a more insidious, quiet form, where they just simply dismantle the country from within that country. It's called Steph Jihad.
They have a headquarters, huh?
A headquarters where you begin to Islamize the society, where you in fact do it through a different route. It ain't all about doing it the way Hamas
Why
would
do they want to put it there at that site?
Provocation.
Why do they even just do that?
That's
to
what I'm talking
about. To provoke the American people?
That's the reading between the lines I'm talking about. why
do you
want to
do
that site?
New York is huge.
If this is about conciliation, which is not, then that would have been taken into consideration, this insensitivity in that. But this is not about conciliation. This is about provocation. The fact that they tore down something in the 911 landscape, and now they're putting a mosque up there to mark the attack.
The death of all those
this
people.
This is jihad. This is Steph Jihad, and this is what the media is not picking up, and what the president didn't understand when he said that this is about religious freedom. Nobody's attacking Muslims in this country, saying they don't have a right to practice their religion. What they're saying is that that site there for the mosque to be built is inappropriate, given what happened there.
Right, and I agree with
and
that.
And that's reading between the lines to say that they are not making a statement against Islam. They are saying that that is inappropriate given the fact that 3,000 Americans are died.
So why would the president get on the air or whatever and say, and there may be a soundbite, he might have had more to what to that conversation than just what they are saying. No, John is shaking his head, no.
This president has a...
Well, he said, you know, but he's going by the Constitution. This man is a constitutional lawyer. What? That's what the New America is supposed to be, free of religious persecution.
Yeah, that's true, but the point is, why at that site, Catherine? Why at that site?
Now, he could have said something against that. He could have said just what George said. That would have been an inappropriate site. Find another site. So why would he sit here and say...
He hasn't said that, though. See, he says, oh, it's fine. He's all perfectly okay with it.
That people can have... he's quoted, this country has... This is a freedom...
Yes, but see, the thing is, the site... Let's face it, Mr. Moss is right. Nobody's trying to object to a mosque in this country. We have four in this city right now. Nobody, to my knowledge, has attacked them.
Yeah, we have to be analytical here.
Site where it's their choosing.
That's the analysis that this country has to get past the jargon. Nobody is saying that Muslims don't have a right to practice religion in the United States. That is not the issue.
Or
the
to build them a mosque. Remember it happened in Hamtramck?
The president did the same thing with this issue that he did with the immigration issue in Arizona, where he said that you can be walking down the street and taking your son or daughter to get a soda, and the officer will stop you on the street and could, in fact,
if
you don't have your papers, can have you arrested. That is not true. And that's not true, and this is not true either. That this is not an issue of the right to practice your religion. This is not the question of the First Amendment, the freedom of religion in the country.
Just tell me, why would they want to do that anyway? Why would they want to do that?
I have an answer. This is
provocation. Besides the provocation.
This has been the history of those who have an aggression against the infidels. We have to go back and look at the long history of Islam clashing with those entities that do not practice Islam. I mean, look what they just did over there with those historic figures of Buddha, where Hamas, Al-Qaeda, one of those groups, blew up those historic those historic shrines. Just no provocation, just blew it up. Mm-hmm. And then look at in Spain, when the Muslims go into Spain in 711 AD and knock down those Christian churches, they built, to mock the destruction, they put mosque in the place of that which they had destroyed as mocking their conquest. This is no different.
But didn't the Christians do the same thing?
Well, it may be the same thing, but I'm simply saying that in this case right here, let's see it for the aggression that it actually is. This is an aggression against a nation that is, and Barry is going to disagree with me, a nation that's 96% Christian. Barry would say in the 70s, it's not a Christian country.
Who is Barry now?
On the program in the morning. We have this argument. Well, you know, it's 96. Here's what I would say. Okay, 4% of the people in this country that practice religion are not Christian. 96% of the practitioners of people that practice religion in this country are, in fact, Christians.
Christians. Yeah, they got a Bible so belt.
So, you know,
that Bible belt is long. Yeah.
It's provocation, and it's intended to be provocation.
Okay,
and
bottom line, are they going to be able to do it?
I don't think
because if they're not able to do it, then I think
that mosque is not going to be built. The reason it's not going to be built is because there's not a contract.
But it has a lot of ramifications with that, George.
I know it does, and if we allow ourselves to keep getting pushed back as they're doing, where we have people building airport housing rooms in airports for people to go in there and wash their feet. Do they have any place for you to go in there and pray in your religion? They got people in, they got foot washing places, prayer rooms in airports.
Muslims pray so many times a day.
Well, are we supposed to accommodate that at public expense?
Five times a day?
Yeah, five times a day. Well, I tell you what we'll do. We will allow these things to go on when the Muslims allow us to have Christian churches in Saudi Arabia.
John gave a thumbs up
on that. They are trying to act like we are intolerant of Islam. The fact of the matter is in many cases, we're too tolerant of Islam. And I'm going to tell you that this is this one guy that's pushing this idea of this mosque. Behind the scenes, underneath, let's analyze information that's out there and ask ourselves a question of what are the comments being made by those who are pushing this plan? And this person that is, in fact, pushing this is on record of saying that the U.S. is culpable in 9/11. That's one of the persons in back of it. That Bin Laden was, in fact, produced by the United States. We are the ones who produced Bin Laden. Bin Laden is produced in the United States. He's one of the ones in back of it. And so, reading between the lines, I think you have to say, okay, what is the intention here? And this is not about conciliation and religious tolerance and any of that. This is intolerance in terms of that, because if it was not, there are many sites in the New York area you can build this mosque. And why are you building it right there where you knock down those buildings if this is not a continuation of jihad under another umbrella?
Are they saying that they're not that Muslim? Those Muslims?
That's what they're saying.
Okay, because it is some peaceful ones.
Well,
some here.
I tell you, a report has been suppressed. And the report of where are they getting the inspiration for jihad? And they can claim Bin Laden and anything they want to claim. But the repressed report is that they found out that the inspiration for the jihad is the Quran itself. Now we can practice political correctness and act like that is not true. It is true that that those persons are fundamentalist Islamic practitioners, and that's just true. I'm sorry, you don't need to read between the lines there. Just have a working knowledge of the information that's out there, particularly the books written by Robert Spencer, Steph Jihad, Islam Unveiled. There are a lot of books out there. They must be stopped by Bridget Gabriel. People not reading information. But for those of us that's reading between the lines, there is no other conclusion that can be drawn. And I'm bold enough to say it. Hmm. But, you know, bothered by...
We'll see, won't we?
The way this information is laid out there. Catherine, here's somebody I want to
bring. Can they sue if they are not allowed? You know what I mean?
It won't be built.
Because they can do that.
It won't be built because there's not a contractor in New York that's going to cover that with a 10. That's going to do that with a 10-foot pole. The builders in New York are not going to touch it. They're offended by the idea. What's the percentage of people that say they don't want that? I think it's 70% of the people that are against building that mosque at 9/11 at Ground Zero. Because look at the fact, it's the equivalent.
I don't think it's right.
It's
personally.
It's the equivalent of building a shrine to the Nazis at Auschwitz, or building
a shrine at
Pearl Harbor.
All these people that were killed and was killed by
these
people.
Can you imagine Japanese Americans saying we want to build a shrine
in
Pearl Harbor?
How
would that be viewed?
They're not going to let that happen.
Why not?
And I don't think they're going to let this happen either.
Americans
will come. One thing I found about them, sometimes, all of them, ethnic groups, when something is going on against Americans, we will pull together.
Mm-hmm.
We will come together. You saying no, John?
Can you hear me? Yeah, because I know. I think this one's very divisive because 29% of the people polled said they have no problem with it. There's a very growing group of people out there who detest being Americans and who want to attack us at every cause, people within our own country. And it's just ridiculous.
So is that apathy?
The progressives.
No, it's not apathy. It's outward contempt.
What percentage would you say, John? What was that percentage?
I say 29%.
29. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. See, send some odd percent.
So we wouldn't come together and stand on that?
Yeah, well, 29%
is not problematical. Okay, so the only people that's coming and raising hell about it,
No.
About it is the people that were family members that were killed in that.
Well, see, even those are divided. 29% of the people of this country, though, we always go from the smallest group of people. We listen to those so-called elite. We're going to listen to them.
And to what they say.
Happen. Yep, they're going to win out because they're going to label anybody who stands in opposition as racist, xenophobic, and anti-Islam. And then when they do that, the Muslims are going to jump on board screaming bloody murder because we're against their religion, which we're not.
Yeah, we're not against where they're building the country is not against Islam. It's against
so it's
some of the
happen.
Provocations going inside those mosques where they are, in fact, exciting people to practice jihad inside the United States and other countries where they are. That's the objection. But when Barack Obama came out there and said that they have the right to practice their religion as all other groups do, that was a misappropriation of the issue in this case here. Because nobody, where are they burning mosques in this country and tearing up Muslim centers of worship in this country? They have the right to worship. That was a total misappropriation of what the issue is in this case here. The objection is that site there is hollow ground given what occurred on 9/11. That's what the objection was.
Was he doing that to be safe?
Because Barack Obama doesn't seem like he does his homework before he makes these outlandish statements.
Yeah, that was what came to my mind. He made that statement without actually getting the facts.
That's one part of it, and I think his sympathies are another part of it. But certainly, he didn't do his homework in terms of what this issue was. But this president has a tendency to shoot off at the mouth without doing his homework, and then this president has
then he got to come back and apologize and retract what he said.
And the question is, why does it happen so consistently where the president goes off and his positions are those which, in fact, are not within the mainstream of American political thought? Why is that? And what is it about the...
He's pro-Islam. He went to a Muslim school.
I'm sorry, John, what you said?
He went to a Muslim school in Indonesia. He's very sympathetic.
So that's what George was saying, his sympathies lie.
Yeah, where are these men's sympathies? Because we are seeing a lot...
His background is Muslim. His father was a Muslim.
If I look at the totality of this man's behavior in the 18 months he's been in the presidency, I've not seen one pro-American stand this man has taken. And I'm bothered by the fact that every time America's is interested at stake and somebody else's interest at stake, America is wrong and another person is right.
But tell me, George, you said step jihad.
Step jihad.
Step. Okay.
Step.
Okay. My understanding, they already have sales here.
Oh, that's what I'm talking about. You see, some of the jihadists, some of it is what they're doing, for example, across these borders. We now know for a fact, reports are now clear, that many of these Al-Qaeda operatives are going to Venezuela getting training in Spanish. Mm-hmm. And they're crossing that border. If they're caught, they can always claim that they are Spanish just coming in to work.
But
they're in here right now. It's sales inside of the United States.
Just being in here right now. They've been here.
And that's Steph
and
Jihad.
And you're seeing some of them happening, like the guy in the army.
Mm-hmm.
They went and just killed all those people.
Oh, yes.
You know? They only let you know. The media only lets you know what they want you to know. It's sales here.
How did this person get up there? This person was a major in the army, right? He was all over the websites with tremendous provocative comments made. Now,
and
why?
They didn't do nothing. They
because
knew about
of
it.
Political correctness, where you turn a jaundiced eye to the evidence that we have these jihadists in important
America?
Strategic places. This is in the military. This is the thing that safeguards our borders. And this man is a major. They went off and
killed
13 soldiers.
People. Thank you.
And wounded 30
that
others.
So that lets us know that our country has some weaknesses.
Yeah, we better start reading between a lot of lines.
Oh, thank before you, this George. Is over. Read between the lines.
Which I do.
Don't just accept what the media tells you.
Yeah, but I want to. But you have to read between the lines with the information there, and not create information and deal with it. I'm saying that we need to read between the lines, but make sure there's some information.
There's some facts that you maybe have researched it, that it's truth mm-hmm. before you put that out there.
Yes.
And I understand that.
Yes.
I always read between the lines because I have a big concern for my people.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it seems like there's nobody really concerned. Even our people ain't concerned about our people. Because if they were, all this murdering would not be going on here.
Yes.
You know, so what's even though the churches come together, we're going to do this, we're going to do that, something missing here.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, to me, it's a lack of concern with us.
No question about it.
With our people.
This murderous
assault. Why won't the man stand up?
Right.
I was up in Saginaw.
No analysis.
I was in Saginaw. Mm-hmm. 10 of these young youth came. They just coming into the festival. Went to the African Culture Festival. They didn't change it. It's not African American anymore. And it's the African Culture Festival.
Okay.
10 of them. Mm-hmm. Doing their thing, loud clowning, okay? They came down, they got down toward where the music part was. Those men stood up, and those boys had to go. They said, we ain't having that here. Mm-hmm. That's all they said.
Mm-hmm. Right.
We ain't having that here.
Right.
So to me, Saginaw black men stand up.
Yeah, and that, yeah. And
okay, you can't leave everything to the churches.
Right. Well, that's the key. If our community stood up against this assault, in a single voice, this could not stand.
Thank you.
But there's this noise out here that we're dealing with something other than that. We're dealing with racism and
we're dealing with our children. This is our children. Children killing each other.
Yeah.
Genocide. No babies can be born if the young girls don't have no men.
We're dealing with something different than what they're telling us we're dealing with. We're dealing with pants on the ground, and when you wear
genocide
pants on the ground, your behavior reflects how you respect yourself, how you present yourself. If your pants on the ground, you're not showing any respect for yourself, and you're not going to respect anybody else if that's what you're allowed to do.
Genocide is killing off the race,
and we are dealing with sidebar issues because the analysis is missing out of
those
our profile.
Distractions.
They are distractions.
But why won't the men rise up? Where are they? Where are they in Flint? You know, besides in the church. I mean, the church can handle only so much.
Mm-hmm.
It comes to the community and the men. Even if they have to come out and start doing patrols, do something.
Mm-hmm.
Do something.
Well, I think that they're doing that for their membership, and people don't go to church, Catherine. I don't know what they can do out there with person that don't.
Well, what about the block clubs? Don't the block clubs have men?
That's what I was saying earlier. I wish we could do a study made of a profile of who these persons are. I mean, there's some people out there doing that. Who are they? Who are they? What are their affiliations?
What's the outcome
in the church, for example, to see if that is
working.
If that's part of the problem too, that they're going to church and not getting the right information,
something.
And they're doing that on the side once they leave the church doors. But I'd be shocked if that were the case. I think that what we have here are those persons that have just given up on those institutions that it can impact that behavior in a different way. But we don't have the stats to say one way or the other, but I'd be surprised if that were in fact the case.
Well, I remember when the block clubs were strong. I remember, because I had block clubs. Everywhere I lived, I've had block clubs. If it wasn't one there, I would start one.
Mm-hmm.
I remember the people coming together, and we were strong. You know, just it wasn't all those killings going on like it is now either.
Mm-hmm.
I remember one time over where I used to live on Burgess, they were going to take it over at Buick Street against the Burgess Street Boys, and they was going to turn it to drugs. They was taking the street over.
Mm-hmm.
I went down the street knocking on doors, asking these men to stand up. I got two.
Mm-hmm.
One of them that lived right across, both of them live across from me. That's how we got control of that little part of Sunny to Pasadena.
Mm-hmm.
Those men stood up.
Right.
Sit up with their guns outside. And I'm not condoning that, but that's what worked. Violence against violence. Mm-hmm. Take it back by force, by violence.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes you had to.
Our silence is definitely a part of the problem. There's no question about that. I was thinking about when you were making that point, what Edmund Burke said, that all that has to happen in order for evil to take over is for enough good men to remain silent.
Quiet.
And so, yeah.
And for me to have to, you know, the men seeing that our street was being taken over, and there was a lot of men over there.
Mm-hmm.
I only got two.
Yeah.
Two men to stand. And that's what happened. That's how we cleaned that right there. Now, they went right down the street to across Sunny, and they I think it's between Sunny and Myrtle. And they went down there and took over this woman's house. But between Sunny and Pasadena, we wasn't having it. And it was a lot of it was because of me.
Mm-hmm.
I would stand up. You have to stand sometime.
Yeah.
You got children, little kids at home. You don't want your children getting shot? Well, you sit down to dinner and somebody's shooting, you get shot?
Yeah, that's one thing I'll say about Elliot, who took over the festival activities.
Mm-hmm.
They do that in their neighborhood on a consistent basis, and it's had a tremendous effect in that area where they live.
And they deal with children,
because
too.
They know that family there stands for a different model of how the black community should, in fact, operate.
She got a garden. She has. They have a garden that they have. Mm-hmm. They got these children teaching them how to garden. Mm-hmm. That's, you know, get out here in this community.
Yeah.
But Elliot is a different, I'd say sometimes a different type of man. He mm-hmm. will stand. Mm-hmm. His yeah. wife will stand. And it's only certain people in this city that will stand up.
Yeah, and they respect that. When those children see that you have an idea, it just can't be shooting off at the mouth. It's got to have some information in back of it. Mm-hmm.
And show and that you also know what show by example.
About. You know, the children look to see mm-hmm. if you really know what you are talking about. They'll listen for a while, but, you know, it's not like they got a long attention span, and they're not going to wait a whole day and a half.
And they also watch to see if you have any fear.
Yeah.
Will you stand up for me?
Yeah, that's part of it, too. Okay, a very important part of it. But if you're blowing in the wind and you don't stand for anything and they can't see what your purpose is and that there is an intent behind it, a studied intent behind it, that you understand some information. Mm-hmm. And if they see that, they understand it's not just somebody shooting from the hip, and they have a certain amount of respect for
respect,
it.
Respect, yes.
Another thing that we could do, you know, this would not be a hard part. Another thing is that we have to give these children something to do. It's like they knock on your door and ask for some work. Well, you know, you don't have any work for them to do. But the point is that a few dollars out of your pocket to buy a relationship, to pay, you know, to get a relationship going with your neighbor helps you to talk to that person. You know,
that works sometime. Yeah. I had some chaps come to me, two little boys. I needed my grass cut. I have a kind of large yard. It's not a little small yard that a lot of them have out there. I told them I would pay them. I asked them how much did they charge. They said $10. I was going to pay them 20, so they have 10 each or whatever, 25. Mm-hmm. Because I know my yard is large. They went around there and looked at it, and they came back and told me, no, we can't do that. Yeah. So it's some.
Well, I'm saying that.
They're serious about getting out here trying to do some work.
But if they ask for... If children come around in a neighborhood and they ask something to do, it's a teachable moment. I mean, we have to open ourselves up to making something available.
Right, George. That's what I was trying to do.
My neighbor came.
Always do
my
that,
neighbor
though.
Who mm-hmm. has run Askins of the Law a little bit came by and knocked on my door. He said, I'm trying to get some money for my school clothes because my mother can't afford the school clothes, blah, 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 blah. You know what? I have a person that cuts my grass every week. I pay him so much money. He comes by.
Yes.
Okay, I didn't have anything for him to do. But I said, look, if you're asking for a job, I'll find something for you to do. Mm-hmm. So I just...
That's what I was trying to do with those little boys.
I'm trying to be an influence in that neighborhood with youth that you can't get up there and lecture these youth. I mean, you're not going up there and there's not going to be a class... I did it because it helps me develop a relationship with him and through him his friends.
And then you're right? getting some little money every two weeks
where
or
I can
whatever
build
from me.
Basis for the conversation. And I learned that from my father, who told me when a person was breaking into his house out there where he planted his garden, way out there in Belleville somewhere. He had a garden out there. He wasn't living on that land. And the guy had a house out there. The guy was breaking into it. He knew who was doing it, the guy down the street. He took the guy and bought him a hamburger. And he said, later on, he said, the break-in stopped. And he was laughing to me about it. He said, you know, it's amazing what a hamburger will do.
Yeah, but like a chap came and he was asking for some school clothes or something like that.
Yeah.
I would take them. And I don't have a lot of money, but I would do what I can.
Mm-hmm.
I'd buy them a little backpack, little stuff they need in that backpack. I would help that way.
Yeah.
But those little boys, I needed somebody to cut my grass. They came to me. I offered them, that was a job, and I told them y'all could do it for me every 2 weeks, every 10 to 14 days, mm-hmm. and come to me and we would do this. That was a job. Mm-hmm. I work with you, so I know when you need a job to come and do, you need something, I'm going to try to find something for you to go out in my garden and pick them greens for me.
We can do that. Okay.
Got to wrap it up.
We can do that. Okay. Well, I think that we covered some important topics. Make sure you stay vigilant out there. We don't know if we got the... all the people off the street that's doing these killings with these knives and so on. I want to stay vigilant until we find out if that person was doing all of these assaults. Until next week, don't forget to follow your dreams, because if you don't follow your dreams, you'll never know what's on the other side of the rainbow. See you next week.
You Everybody's got a dream.